Anupam, you can see.
Yeah. So, good morning, everyone, and welcome to this very interesting webinar on e-invoicing. And I welcome you on behalf of ACIA and CII. And to take this forward, I would like to welcome our chairman, Sri Maulik Bhansali, who will be taking forward this webinar from here. Sri Maulik Bhansali, who is our chairman and director on board of ACIA.
Thank you, Anupam. Good morning, friends. Good morning, friends from GSTN, friends from the industry. It's my great pleasure in welcoming you all on this very important subject of invoicing. We at GACIA, GACIA talking about GACIA, we are an ICT body of Gujarat, with more than 500 plus members, IT companies and software companies and electronics as well, representing that industry from Gujarat. And have been working very closely with the industries, with the policymakers on various policy advocacy as well, with an objective of course, getting our ecosystem ready for the larger benefit for the industry and the state and all the stakeholders. And as part of that, it gives me great pleasure, therefore, today to have this, welcome everyone for this webinar, which is on invoicing. And we all know that invoicing is a very important subject. And there are several questions that many of our industries would possibly have, and how also in the IT industry can support this initiative. That's also a very important angle. And of course, while the objective is to kind of make the entire process very efficient, and I've been reading about it and how other different countries have adopted and how India is also going towards that, it's equally important for us to understand and, demystify a few facts about it and understand it a little bit better, articulate the voice of industry on different challenges, potential challenges as well, and to be able to really discuss and have more understanding on that and more clearer understanding on that. We have organized this webinar along with CII today, and we have invited GSTN to be part of it and to help us understand this much more better. Of course, we will also go through, questions and answers. But here, let me kind of outlay the overall plan or overall program as how we're going to proceed forward. We'll have presentations by Mr. Prakash Kumar and Mr. Pankaj Dixit from GSTN. We'll then run through some very important questions and, of course, answers that we will get on those and understand much more better on very important queries from the industries and various different colleagues of ours in the industry. And those will be addressed by Mr. Prakash and Mr. Pankaj. We'll then be followed by questions from our panelists as well, to Mr. Prakash and Mr. Pankaj, and following that, any further more discussions that we may want to have. With that, let me introduce our speakers and our eminent guests today amongst us. We have Mr. Prakash Kumar, who is CEO with GSTN, and prior to this, he worked with giants like Microsoft and Cisco for more than 6 years, and before moving to private sector in 2008. He also worked as an officer with Indian Administrative Services for more than 2 decades, I believe for 23 years, where he handled several various portfolios, including IT, sales tax, human resource management, and industrial development, amongst others. So we welcome you, sir. Thank you, Prakash sir, for being here today amongst us. We also have Mr. Pankaj Dixit, Colonel Pankaj Dixit, and he has very rich and varied experience in domain of information technology, having successfully designed technology solutions for cutting-edge technologies with the defense forces for more than 2 decades. And then after that, he worked with IBM for 2.5 years, and now with GSTN, and he's at the helm of the entire IT infrastructure, IT operations, and IT services provisioning. We welcome you, sir, and it's a great pleasure to have you amongst us today. We are also having presence of amongst us Mr. Vinod Garwal, who is Vice Chairman of CII Gujarat. Mr. Vinod, thank you being with us today. And we are also having presence of Mr. Sanjay Podar, who is president and commercial head with Ultratech Cement, Aditya Birla Group. We have Mr. Paras Jain, president group, indirect taxation with Wellspun Group. We have Mr. Ankit Mundra with Cloudtail India. He is head of taxation over there. We have Mr. Mohan Nusetti, who is vice president and head of indirect tax with Lupin. We have Mr. Prabhat Ranjan, controller indirect taxation with Abbott India. We have Ms. Manti Dugar from Hindustan Unilever. She is heading taxation operations over there. We have Mr. Ritesh Kanodia of Dhruva, and our own Mr. Neeraj Hathe Singh, who is founder and managing director with Signet Infotech. So we, as you can see, we have all these experts and industries on the same platform here today discussing this very important subject on invoicing. I would not really waste much more time, but hand over to Mr. Prakash and Mr. Pankaj to carry on with the presentations, and then followed by the questions from our industries, and then followed by the questions from our panelists as well. Over to you, Mr. Prakash and Mr. Pankaj. Thank you, and very well welcome to you today.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bansali, CII Gujarat, ACIA, for inviting me and Pankaj to be part of this webinar. I hope my audio is clear.
Yes, you are.
Okay. While the presentation is being set up, I just wanted to tell you something which we are discussing prior to start of the webinar. That this is not reporting to tax department, but this is a measure to improve how businesses interact with each other. And more than 130 countries worldwide have already adopted it in some form or the other. Some of them are in very advanced stage where they are now talking of exchange of purchase order payment through the same platform. And the ultimate aim is that how a buyer and a seller can exchange information digitally in a most secured manner. What gets reported to the tax department is bonus on top of that. So that is where we are, and it brings it cuts down your error, largely transcription error, or and also improves your cycle of payment reconciliation and things of that sort. The presentation hasn't come as yet. Okay, so can we go to the next one? Next. So this concept, okay, so Pankaj, if you can just, it here. Yeah, so what I wanted to emphasize before all of you is you or your units can continue to work the way you used to do earlier. For you, there is no change. The change is to be done by your IT service provider. How? That invoice is to be generated in a particular format and reported to the government. Today, all of you, all are large companies of our country, and you use some reputed ERP. So you are generating in some format. All we have done here is given a format which is based on worldwide accepted PayPal format or UBL format. And in that, you just pass it on to the tax department. Now, that has to be done by your service provider, IT service provider. And once, if it is generated in that particular form, it goes to invoice registration portal. And the invoice registration portal, after some certain validation, signs the invoice with a digital signature, adds a QR code, and sends it back to you. And then it's up to you how you share it with your buyer. Now, that invoice also gets reported by the IRP to GST system. And the idea is that we create your GST R1 on day-to-day basis, as and when you report. So by end of the month, after the month has ended, in 48 hours, your certain tables of your GST R1 will be ready. Now, what happens once the GST R1 is there, the buyer can also view in his GST R2A, and of course, see how the supplier has uploaded and what is the ITC which is basically coming to him. Can you go to the next one, Pankaj? Pankaj, next one. Next slide. Yeah, so this is how it will look like, and you have a QR code on the top, In fact, lots of questions were there, whether we have to keep it on left or right. All these are yours, whichever way you want. Whether to print IRN or not, that's also your thing. If it is, it is contained in QR code. And after that, it is up to you. If you want to print it, fine. If you don't want to print it, don't print it. But QR code is mandatory. And some people ask, do we need to print everything which is there? Now, again, this is a format for reporting. What you print is between, as per your contract with your buyer. And that is what you put it there. So it is not that all 150 columns you need to print. That's basically I wanted to emphasize here. Next, please. This access mechanism and all Pankaj will talk about. I thought I will just, Pankaj, if you can just...
in fact, they just connect. Yes, sir, for the access, what needs to be told is that...
I'll just come to some of the question and answer, which I have a slide.
Okay.
And... Yes. So what we have done here, we have put some of the questions which have been raised before us into 7 categories. One is, what is this invoice registration portal? And some of the policy issues which have been raised. Which taxpayer has to be, has to file it mandatorily today? How do we handle bill to ship to? What are the components of invoice? Then how invoice and GSTR1 are related? Then how invoice and EWA bills are related, and what is the schema of invoice? So all the additional queries, there are lots of questions and answers already put on GSTN's portal, which is there on the top. And I'll suggest you go and see there. These are all additional ones which have been asked. Now, one question was exemption from e-invoicing with nature of business. Like suppose you are a bank and you are also doing selling some infrastructure. Now your banking business is exempted, but not the infrastructure. So it is not for the entity, it is for the business. Next, is there any time period within which IRN can be cancelled? This is 24 hours, the way we do for EWA bill. It's exactly EWA bill, which is working for last more than 28 months. We have just adopted those practices here. Whether attributes like QR code, IRN, IRN dates are required mandatorily to be printed. So printing of QR code is compulsory. Others, it's up to you whether you want to print it or not. And place of QR code is completely as per your choice. Is e-invoicing applicable to supplies by notified persons to government departments or PSUs? This question has been asked in many places. Now here, government department... first, let me take PSU. PSU will be largely in the business of supply of goods and services. So they will need this invoices, so that with their GSTN as buyer, so that they can take ITC on that. So if they are into business of supplying services or goods, their regular GSTN has to be used. If they don't have anything, don't give it, then it is a B2C. In case they have just tedious registration, like your public works department, irrigation department, they are not into supplying services to as a business. So in that case, there'll be a tedious registration that can be used. However, further clarification, government will be issuing on that. Then can e-commerce entity generate invoice on behalf of sellers? One of your colleagues, he's there. Of course, he's a provider to one of the platforms. And this question has been raised in many forums. What we have said that, yes, it can be done. They are doing it today. They are generating invoice. They're taking payment. They are handling return, cancellation, everything they are doing. So this also they can do. There is no bar on this. Next, Pankaj. Then what is the maximum number of lines which have been asked? So in EWA bill, we had 200. Here we have increased to 1,000. And if people have more than 1,000 lines in their invoice, please send us the details so that we can make necessary enablement for you. Only for those. So we'll have a separate queue for those guys who have large number of lines in an invoice. Then if someone is below 500 crores, can they participate now? The answer is not now. We would like first to make it operational, stabilize, and maybe at the end of October, we will open it for others also to participate. Then how to know a particular supplier is supposed to issue invoice? The list is already there for last 10 days on e-invoice portal, and you can just go and search it there. This question has been raised again by some of those who are selling to retailers. And I don't want to take any name, but there are companies which only sell to retailers. And their question was, if there is a breakdown of internet connectivity, what do we do? Now, for that, this, we have taken up with the government, and some mechanism to provide relaxation will be notified soon, that how to handle. Because this happens, law and order situation or something happens. So what do we do? Business cannot stop. Business has to go on. So there will be some mechanism to do that. Next, please. Coverage. Here, SEZ units exempted, yes, but not SEZ developers. SEZ developers will be covered by this. Then, is e-invoicing applicable to suppliers by notified persons to SEZ? Question is yes. Then FTWZ is also a kind of special economic zone, and hence they are, it, the same treatment will be given in their case. One question was asked, you people export, whether port code is mandatory. It is not a mandatory item. It is an optional item. Then how to know a particular supplier is supposed to issue invoice, that I've already covered earlier. Is invoicing applicable for supplies by notified persons? That also we have covered. Then, okay, the last one, is invoicing applicable to invoices issued by ISD? The answer is no. This is not applicable when you are further distributing your credit to your daughters. I mean, we call it in our terms, daughter units. Please go to the next one. Bill to ship to, lots of questions have been asked here. And here what, the way we do it in eBay Bill, the ship to will be taken up here. However, schema has place for both addresses, bill to as well as ship to. So after lots of discussion yesterday with another group, they suggested that you take the bill to in GSTR1. So that ITC flows to the bill to guys. And ship to you take into, so that eBay bill can be created. So we'll, this is a good suggestion, and this is what we'll work upon. Next one. Then we have components of invoice. There are lots of questions, like other charges, how to handle that. So our suggestion here is that add one more line and you can handle it there. Then is ERP going to validate details of referred invoices of credit note, debit note? See, it is going to be implemented from 1st of October. So before any invoice before that will not be there. So there is no linkage. And secondly, we don't intend to keep it, keep the data for longer period there on invoice registration portal. So no such validation will be there. And lastly, in 10 days time, this delinking of credit note, debit note is going to be implemented in GST. So anyway, this question will not arise at that. The next one is, in the current schema, there is no provision to report details of supplies not covered under GST, like hotel wants to give single invoice for alcohol as well as food. So what our suggestion is that please issue separate invoices, GST invoices, GST items in GST invoice, other items in non-GST invoice. And many states have already made it mandatory under their jurisdiction. So this is a better practice so that there is no problem. Then UOM field can be made as a free text. The idea here is to capture this data for analysis. Currently in eBay bill, it is not mandatory. And what we have seen, all kinds of garbage is coming there. So now this, we want to get this data as well. Then are bill of supply delivery challan under scope of invoice? No, they are not. It's only currently invoice, credit note, debit note. Then is ARP going to validate details of referred invoices? This is already covered above. Rounding off needs to be done at the line item level or at the invoice level. So rounding off as per GST law is at the invoice level, not at the line item level. And this is what all ERPs also follow. Then same invoice cannot be sent to IRN generation even when previous IRN is cancelled. See, here there is lots of confusion amongst those who are not using ERPs. ERPs don't allow you to cancel an invoice and use the same invoice for generating another invoice. Unless it is a pro forma invoice. And I'm not talking of pro forma invoice. If you have generated an invoice and you want to cancel it, you cancel that and another fresh invoice number will be used. And that is as per accounting standard, and we are going to, that's what is going to be made mandatory here. If you have canceled, cancel. Now go to the next one. And this will also take care in GSTR1. Another question was, is the signature of supplier mandatory while reporting the invoice to IRP? No, it is not. We will sign and give it to you as a proof of having been reported to invoice registration portal. In the current schema, there is no provision to report details of supplies not covered under GST. That, as I mentioned about the hotel thing, restaurant, you have separate invoice. It is not to be covered. Only GST invoices are to be reported here. There was another question here. Is in e-invoice schema, the field differential rate percentage applicable to leasing of vehicles purchased lease prior to July 1, 2017 is not available. Since it was relevant only up to 30th June and we are starting this from 1st of October, naturally this is not required here. Rounding off, we have already taken care of whether B2C invoices can be reported to IRP. Our ultimate aim will be to do that so that you don't have to bother. Your ERP generates and it keeps on pushing. But at this stage, we are not doing. We are going in step by step. The way we had done e-way bill, like we started first with interstate, then we became intrastate. It started with one state and then we went to all the states. Here we have to start with all the states. So B2C invoices will not be reported now, but later, yes, it will bring that as well. So that your entire GSTR1 can be created. You don't need to then do anything. No separate reporting to us. Then whether attributes like QR code, IRN required to be printed, this we have already handled earlier. Then acknowledgement number and date, which is given by the registration portal, whether it is required to be printed. Our answer is, this is for your reference. It is not required to be printed. If you want to print it, fine. It is between you and your buyer. But the law does not insist that you should print. Can I amend details of a reported invoice for which IRN has already been generated? This is what Neeraj was asking, that suppose by mistake you have given the ISD GST or the non-ISD, whichever way, and you want to amend it. Or many times it happens, like HUL is sending and for supplies sent to Gurgaon, Delhi units numbers are given. So they need to amend it. So those amendments can continue to be, I mean, that can be done on GSTR portal through GSTR1, but not through IRP. IRP is the original one invoice we've created, that's created, that's it. After that, whatever you're changing, amending, that will go into the GSTR1. That's the way it is. Invoice is generated, printed by supplier. What are the mandatory contents of such invoice issued, printed? So this is for the reporting purposes, what has been notified. What you print is as per your practice and, of course, the GST law, applicable GST law. Go to the next one, please. Pankaj, huh? What will be the storage archiver? Now, this is as per the GST law, which mandates 72 months. The way you are storing, archiving your invoices today in paper form, the same thing will be there in the electronic form as well. There is no change on that. The amount of other charges we have discussed. Then in e-invoice schema, there is no placeholder for mentioning TCS collected by suppliers. These both are same. And the notification which was issued in December 18 says that taxable value for purpose of GST shall include the TCS. So this needs to be read like that. Can we go to the next one? Now here onwards, okay, this I will take and after that Pankaj will start. This is a question, how will we use the invoice data which is reported at line item level, where the same HSN code may appear multiple times because your that unit will be different. Your items may be having different codes. So we will be, our system will now read them, same HSN items will be clubbed together for the same rate of tax, and that is was at for GSTR1, it will be clubbed together and taken into the relevant tables. So 4A, 4B, 4C, 6B, 6C will go to B2B invoices. I'm sure you will be aware, we are doing this today also for e-way bill. We create your GSTR1 for all the invoices which are reported in e-way bill. We create and keep it for you to download. Unfortunately, the use is not very high. In fact, it is very, very low. And the reason is all your invoices are not getting there. So it's a pain for a company, large companies which are here, to do reconciliation, look for which are not reported and then report it. Here, what will happen here, all your B2B invoices, all your export invoices, all your credit or debit note will necessarily be reported to IRP. So all the table 4A, B, 4C, 6B, 6B, 6C, 6A and 9B will be completely populated. And your HSN void summary in table 12 also will also be done. So, and if there is a cancellation, we'll handle it and remove the auto-populated cancelled invoice. And you can always edit up to filing of GSTR1 or after filing of GSTR1 as it happening today. Next, please, Pankaj. Then, in fact, there is a question here. What happens if you have uploaded invoice first and also in GSTR1? People will try all kinds of things. They will try to see how system behaves. They will first put in GSTR1, then we will put in invoice, or they will put simultaneously. So we have to come up with some logic, which one will get precedence and how will we handle it. So that is what we have written here. One very important part is that if you have created e-way bill and that e-way bill has been checked by an officer, you can't cancel e-way bill and you can't cancel IRA. So that also we have built into the system. Here onwards, now I'll request Pankaj to take care of the technical parts. Pankaj, you can take from here. No, the next page onwards.
Yeah. Sorry, thank you, sir. So these are the mappings of the e-invoice schema fields to the GSTR1. As has just been told, that your GSTR1 will get populated from the e-invoice, certain tables as were mentioned. And these are the parameters of the invoice schema, which will map to the GSTR1 field. So these will be more for your IT teams, but suffice to show that majority of the GSTR1 population happens through the invoice. And it reduces a lot of effort on the part of your IT teams, as well as your accounting teams. And there are just a couple of two key tables, which you then need to populate to finally prepare your GSTR1 for submission. These are some queries regarding the returns. Now, will the IRN number also be populated in GSTR1? And if so, will this be required to save GSTR1 API? Now, IRN will be saved in the GST system database. And right now, it is important to note that IRN is generated on the basis of certain key fields, that is the GST of supplier, buyer, invoice number, and date. And these four cannot be edited. So once the QR code has been generated, then you have this, in case you want to go for cancellation, you will have to cancel the entire invoice. And the IRP will have the data reported. So in case you change any of these parameters, it results in a change of invoice, and hence cancellation is the only option which you have. Now, there's a feedback that we got that Litus is not accepted as a UM, but on IRP and e-way bill portal, it's allowed. So this will be aligned to ensure that Litus will be accepted as a UM. If now next question is about, will GSTR2A also be modified to include the IRN as planned earlier? So we are doing this systematic study, and the GSTR2A also subsequently, if examined by us and found suitable, we will populate the IRN and the IRN date also in the GSTR2A. After the invoice, data is auto-populated into GST1. Can the details be edited? Yes, as explained earlier, that one, either you can cancel the invoice within 24 hours, or secondly, in case you need to edit the details, you'll have to go to the GST system and then make those changes. The reverse flow from GST system to invoice portal will not happen, because when you make the edit, it may be possible that the invoice is no more existing in the IRP. And in any case, IRP keeps your invoices only for 24 hours, or so that you can only cancel it, because no edit is allowed here. For the purpose of auto-population into GSTR1, which date will be considered? So it will be the date of the invoice, which will be used to populate the GSTR1. This is to ensure that the reporting there's no conflict in the reporting periods. Will there be separate APIs to fetch the data or to amend the GSTR1? Yes, APIs will be made available for making those changes. In the case of continuous supply, how the invoices will be treated where the supply was made prior to October 1, but the invoice is issued after October 1. So the reporting is based on date, and accordingly, the changes will be. There are related questions also, that since e-invoice is coming only after 1st October, will there be a validation check for credit note, debit notes prior to October 1? There will be no such checks prior to October 1. Can we get the same credentials to access e-way bill and e-invoice? Yes, same credentials will be provided. There were some inconsistencies which were given as a feedback between the HSN and UM, between the e-way bill and the e-invoice. Will this get addressed? Yes, the masters are going to be updated so that it's common. If the e-way bill gets created using e-invoice API, when will the e-way bill data get replicated to the e-way bill system? Now, since these are all electronic and IT systems, this population will happen almost instantaneously. So if a system is using the e-invoice system to generate the GSTR1 also and the e-way bill also, if you fill in the relevant parameters, your e-way bill will get generated instantaneously. Is carrying of e-invoice print during transportation of goods mandatory? In case you can carry it electronically and make available the invoice electronically to the inspecting officer on the road, then print copies not required. If there are some challenges with regard to that, then it's better to carry a print copy. If e-way bill has been generated first and data is uploaded for invoice generation, would the taxpayer be allowed to generate IRN post e-way bill generation? So the sequence here, as CEO was just telling earlier, that people will try to game the system. So we have put in a logic and we are explaining it to everybody that first you have to create the invoice and IRN, and thereafter you have to go in for the e-way bill generation. Then similarly, cancellation of e-invoice and e-way bill through one request, we generate.
So just to clarify here, by reporting, you can do only reporting, create IRN. If you want e-way bill, you can do e-way bill. And what they have also done, that if you've already generated IRN and you want to create separately second time e-way bill, you can do it through IRN also. You can do it through IRN, you can do it through e-way bill. So that you don't have the idea that if you click that I want e-way bill, you can generate it. Your another question will be, my part B is not filled. I didn't know the vehicle number. So that you can do on either e-way bill portal or here. But if you know, it is better that you give everything so that you both the things get generated. In fact, our technology providers, all the partners, they have shown us people are able to generate both the things together. So you send once, your IRN also comes or your e-way bill also comes. Please go ahead, Pankaj.
Yes, sir. So similarly, we have put in a logic for the cancellation also. Cancellation of e-invoice and e-way bill through one request. So the sequence for this is, there is no provision for simultaneous cancellation. First, you have to cancel the e-way bill, and then you can cancel the IRN, again, subject to that limit of 24 hours. Because the IRN in the IRP system will be available only for 24 hours for cancellation, or the next following day, as was explained earlier. E-way bill regeneration, can e-way bill regeneration be allowed post-implementation of e-invoice? Yes, regeneration, you can regenerate the e-way bill or the same IRN. Now, transportation mode, as was being explained here, is mandatory, even if only part A is to be generated. In e-way bill, if part A is to be generated, then only distance and transport ID is mandatory and not the transport mode. In proposed schema, this transport mode field is made optional and brought in lines with the e-way bill. So yes, transport mode is not mandatory for part A, and this has been changed. Secondly, transporter ID is to be changed from optional to conditional mandatory. Yes, this has been changed in the EV bills, Part A and Part B. Distance to be changed from mandatory to conditional mandatory for Part B. No, since distance is mandatory, Part B has been chosen to be filled.
And what we are doing now, in fact, in EVA bill, we introduced pin-to-pin code distance. We got this mapping done. For all the pin codes in the country, distance between two pin codes. And that we have been using for almost 1 year on EVA bill portal. Now it has stabilized all possible combinations we have aggregated. And we have given an option now, and we'll be announcing it, that if you don't know, just put zero. Our system will calculate and put it there. So you don't need to worry about it. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So the mechanism to handle distance handling has been proposed. Now the schema mandatory requires to enter a preceding document number and date. But this particular requirement is optional. So hence, this was a question. So this is answered that it is an optional item. Will the field list of specific data fields, states, and various masters be provided? Yes. All these masters are going to be provided on the portal, so that you don't have to use your own, or you don't get add wrong entries into the system.
So we have done here, state code list is as per GST. Currency and country code is as per ISO. So that there is no, when you write to send your invoice to other countries also, there is no confusion on that. It's exactly as per international standard. That is what we have done here.
Similarly, the special character list will also be provided. So next question was about defining the lengths of the payload for QR code as well as the invoices. So what needs to be understood is that the signed QR code is of course of fixed length. However, the invoice size will depend on what payload. Someone is sending one line item, somebody is sending 1,000 line item. So the size of the payload will be different. Hence, the payload size cannot be defined. They wanted invoice schema attributes to be shared for mapping the EVA bill schema and GST1. So this will be provided, and the exact mapping of the parameters will be given on the portal. Some error codes have been asked, so all the error codes will be made available on the sandbox portal.
In fact, it's already made available.
It's already there. Yes. For distance API, we already discussed as to how the distance will be handled. In EVA bill, the state code for the other country is 99 and e-invoice it is 96. So the system will accept both, because right now there is one, and later on the system will be aligned and taken care of internally. Lastly, there is a quantity field which has been defined as 10.3 and in EVA bill it is 8.2. So this will be changed in the next version of the EVA bill. So that's it with the FAQs. We can go to.
So what we did, we thought that whatever is being asked, we'll just put it here, and then we'll open for any additional question you have. One thing which you people had raised before the webinar started about the service industry invoicing. And I was told that generally by 5th or 6th of the subsequent month, invoice is generated. So we want to understand what is the problem in that. If it is generated on 5th, you report on 5th, you will get it on that day.
Can I just explain this scenario that means for a IT services company, the timesheets entry and the collaboration of the data that you have to report on the monthly basis.
Understood.
It happens after 5th or 6th. It takes time.
Correct.
Now, for the clients that are overseas, we are supposed to report it in the 31st date or the 30th date only. So this is a typical challenge. This is same.
No, but, I just wanted to know. They also know that by 5th it is compiled. Why can't it be generated for June month on 5th of July?
That is kind of, it's a basic practice which has been followed. It definitely will have to look into it, because if we get only 24 hours, then we will have to generate it on 5th and 6th. And for the financial data, we will have to take it into the previous month, because actually our invoice, which we are raising, is for the previous month. So even if we have to pay the taxation onto it, the GST, then if it is, means like if I am generating for the August month, then my liability comes for the August month, not for the September month. So if I'm reporting in September, but I still need to pay the taxes into August month, and government gets the taxes 1 month earlier if we invoice into the 31st month. So
my suggestion is, Neeraj, this is something which is a policy decision.
Yes.
Take it. policy wing. This has come from multiple industry associations. Everywhere I have requested, please write to them, giving a justification that what you are explaining, this is the typical problem which service industry has, so that they can take an appropriate view on this.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Any other question if you people have? I'll tell you because in 7-8 minutes we'll have to leave for another webinar of NASSCOM, where there will be mostly question on service and software.
One more question, the 500 crore. So you explained the 3 years time frame on how the 500 crore will be calculated, and once somebody is there, they cannot move out. If you can just elaborate a little bit, because that is also a major confusion.
Okay, so I'll tell you why the reason for confusion is the way notification has been worded. In GST law, it always talks about previous financial year. Everywhere it is previous financial year. Correct. Whether you are 5 crore, 1.5 crore, 100 crore, 500 crore. So your aggregate annual turnover is computed based on previous year data. Here they have said in a financial year. So we were also foxed, which was, what is it? Is it current? So whenever you cross, or it is previous. So what we have been told, and they will be notifying, they will be making correction in the notification so that it becomes clear that once you, any year after GST came into being, if you had crossed as a, on that pan more than 500 crores, they are, then you are into this. So that is what we have been told, but it will be notified correctly so that everyone understands. Today's notification is not very, very clear.
And even if it goes down below the, in the current year, he will still have to retain.
So that is what I said. So once you are in, you are in. So you become a Dada industry. So you are in a Dada industry. That's it. 500 crore. Sanjay ji.
So in your presentation, you mentioned about TCS being part of the taxable supply, taxable item. So that is a very... I got very confused with this statement because...
So what I had pointed out is the notification of December 2018, the way they have given it. What our the tax officers have advised us, that please tell them to use another line item in the invoice to show it.
So my question is, stems from there only. Suppose I'm making an invoice for a service or a product of 1 lakh rupees. Mm-hmm. To be deducting TCS of, I'm supposed to be charging the buyer 500 rupees towards TCS. Now, okay. This is the advanced income tax that I'm collecting on behalf of the buyer and submitting to the department. How can this be a part of a taxable good?
My understanding is that there can't be any GST on top of that, right. But that because that's a thing which you've collected on behalf of the. But that is what the notification says. So we have also sought clarification that how it is to be treated. If they write, will they write 0% tax against that?
The second point that I had was you touched upon the bill to ship to concept. Mm-hmm. Now, in our industry, we also have a scenario of multiple ship tos for the same bill to. And the material going in a one truckload, having 4 or 5 ship tos.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we tackle that then?
So the same invoice you cannot have at 5 different locations.
But my bill two is the same.
Bill two, then you have there is a different concept of combined e-way bill, where in a truck, when you are moving goods on multiple e-way bill or multiple invoices, then you have a separate e-way bill for that. And that keeps on changing. The moment you offload something and load something into the truck, then that combined e-way bill again changes. So that has to be handled in e-way bill the way you are handling it today. So there is no problem on that front.
Good morning. Sir, I would like
to ask something.
So
I just wanted to clarify on the inverse side of it. For example, my vendor who's liable to put the iron or the QR code on the invoice, who's liable for e-invoicing. If he sends out an invoice without the QR code or maybe with the incorrect QR code, how does it impact the ITC for the recipient?
Okay, like, so I'll ask you, let's go to the basic. If you receive will it go into his GSTR1 or not?
It won't. It should not go without IRN.
Without IRN, it will not go. But if there is an IRN, it will go into his GSTR1. Your question yes, will be, if my GSTN is not there, then it will not come to my...
No, my question is not if my GSTN is not there. It's more towards how do I validate the QR code or the IRN that my vendor
is... QR code validation, in fact, very soon they will be putting this. It has already been developed, a mobile app. So you can just... In fact, any... even Paytm mobile app, you just scan, it gives you the, all the 9 items which are there in the QR code. So you can read and we can also see whether it is digitally signed or not by IRP.
Okay. And is there any API being planned? So for me to pull out all my inwards data from the system itself and integrate with my SAP or my ERP?
No, at this stage, it is not there. That is what I mentioned. We are working on so that your supplier through this peer-to-peer service can send it to you as it is reported to the tax department so that you can pull it into your ERP and your ERP gets updated. That is what we are working in parallel to put in place that kind of.
So the question I have, sir, is that one is that whether e-invoicing is applicable for RCM and ISD. We all understand it should not be, but
ISD it is not there. ISD it is not there, as I had mentioned. RCM only if your service provider, say for example, a big transporter is under RCM, and his turnover is more than 500 crore, then he has to issue invoice and he has to report. It is his responsibility, not yours.
Absolutely.
That is not your invoice. Even if you are generating on because it is your, you are supposed to do it, it is not your invoice. So this has been clarified by the government. And in fact, all these are coming up in an FAQ, which will be issued by the government. So that these are taken care of.
I think
the second question I have, Niraj, is that everyone is actually looking for a full stop to the schema and version changes because any further
changes will certainly. After this, I know your pain. Prabhaji, you should also understand our pain. We are in the same boat.
I understand, sir. But you know, the whole issue is that it will derail the day one readiness.
After this, no more changes. In fact, that is what I've also requested. If at all you have to do it later. Ideally speaking, no changes should happen now. And this is what we have requested.
Yeah. Ankit and Paras, just one last question because I'll have to let sir go in 2 minutes.
Okay. So it's a very small question. Is there any like particular size for that QR code? Because we have been told by SAP that is 2x2 should be the...
Not fixed anything, but don't squeeze it. Don't make it so small that it can't be read on a mobile device. That's all we are saying. And if you are printing on dot matrix, certainly it will not be read by any mobile app. So that precaution has to be taken.
Thank you.
Sorry, just one last question from my side. Are we planning to have more than one IRP at the time of launch?
Yes. No, not at the time of launch, but very soon. Today we will have only 48,000 GSTINs. 7,800 PAN.
In fact, sir,
and most of you will be reporting at PAN level because you have centralized accounting system. Your GSTINs are not separately reporting. So basically, we'll be handling 8,000 entities which are reporting into our system.
In fact, sir, just to support, I mean, in relation to that question for multiple IRPs, we have already put out an expression of interest and RFI on our website. So, in case there are IT companies which need to respond to this, you may like to go. Our website address is there. So, you can look in the tender section and please respond. Last date is the 15th September 2020.
So, this time we are going in a different, this will be transaction based.
Yeah. So you are, one last question from Ritesh. He just wants to ask one question.
Yeah. Sir, I wanted to ask you, there are two different dates now. One is the invoice date and one is the date when I upload the invoice data. Are all statutory compliant in terms of
invoice data? Invoice data.
And also,
see, GST law, if you read any, you take up any form, it says invoice number, invoice date.
So currently the understanding is because there is no gap between an invoice date and invoice date and the invoice date, therefore the maximum difference could only be one day, correct?
That is the general understanding, but except that what our colleagues from service industry has just now told us.
Absolutely. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry, Neeraj and thank all the people so from CI. We have to leave because we had already committed for NASSCOM earlier. And once Neeraj told us, we can't say no to Neeraj. So
thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your presence. And it was really excellent for us. And thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Pankaj.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
And I think, Anupam, we can have the CII, Vinodji's talk on to it. And then we can go for the panel discussion if that's fine.
Into it. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Neeraj. Thank you very much. Yeah.
I'd like to.
Yeah, Anupam, please.
This viewpoint on this new development. So over to you, Vinod Agarwalji.
Yeah. Thank you, Anupamji. Thank you, Neeraj. Thank you, Jesia. Mr. Maulik Bansali, Chairman, Jesia, IT Association of Gujarat. Mr. Prakash Kumar, CEO, GSTN. Colonel Pankaj Dikshit ji. Anupam ji, all my industry friends from different big companies, panelists, and all the viewers watching live us. See, it's a very good platform, and today whatever we have gathered together, like industry, particularly manufacturing industry, the service industry, that is the IT association, and the government, that is the GSTN platform, has come together to find out the solution. What we see that after this 2K bug, which came up entire world after that 2000 has to change their entire IT platforms. This is now the biggest challenge everybody is facing to integrate themselves into this GSTN platform. So that is why the more work of IT industry has come up, as well as big companies. Right now it's like 500 crore they have kept the marking. But after this change in MSME definition, almost 95% industry will be covered once they remove this cap of 500 crores. That time more work will come, because now more than 500 crore companies work is limited, because they have established IT infrastructure, IT dedicated team, so work will come easy. And once the government will open up for the lower industry, because now we see almost 95% of Indian industry comes under MSME bracket. So that time the work of IT and JCI will be more important. Now, most of the questions today Mr. Prakash and Mr. Pankaj has queried and replied, because today I received a lot of questions similarly, and they have been answered, like how, if suppose there is a no printed invoice, then how the inspector on the way they will deal with the trucks or whatever the goods. So that is the biggest problem, because to get the detailing, to get the information to the lowest level constable or a policeman standing at the road, how he will allow the cargo to move freely. One point is that. Second point, what Mr. Prakash mentioned, that it is very important that we are going for 132 countries alignment of our invoicing. So that will also help us to bring down the compliance of India and becomes globally acceptable invoices. Yesterday we were with DGP Mr. Ashish of Gujarat, and we were discussing more on the counterfeiting and IP problems which we are facing in India. Because as we are opening up, there are a lot of industries, like big companies are facing with products, counterfeit products like Nike, Adidas, or FMCG products, Coca-Cola, and many products. So if once we will be moving on this foolproof invoicing platform, currently on B2B and then to B2C, then the company will be able to know exactly how much quantity they are producing and how much has been sold. And this will help to find out the counterfeit products also. So this kind of information and the seminar which you have organized today is really commendable, and we will really share more information, and if more queries will be there from our industry members, we will come back to you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Anupam.
Anupam ji.
Yeah, thank you, Vinod Agrawalji, for your keynote address. And this was very interesting. Different views from the panel and from the government which came across. I will definitely take note of this and take it forward for put over to Hati Singh ji for the further discussion on this webinar. So over to you.
Yeah, I think we can start with the panel discussion. And Anupam ji, you would like to introduce the panelist and then we can move on to the panel discussion.
So, for the panel discussion, we have just 1 minute. Actually, my internet connection is slightly lower.
We can self-introduce ourselves and then that would be better.
Yeah.
So, I think we can start with the panel discussions, and I'll just request all of you to give some opening statement on how the invoicing will be effective and what you see into that, what is the readiness, and a little bit. So, Sanjay sir, from you, if you can start on to that.
So, good morning. I am Sanjay Poddar from UltraTech Cement. I head the commercial function for UltraTech. And we are into various products, which is cement. While the country and the world knows us for cement, we are also the largest manufacturer of RMC in this country. We are also hugely, in a large way, we are into various building products, which is there. So, as far as talking about the e-invoicing thing goes, and as we discussed with the GST and authorities, this is not, they were not willing to discuss anything on the policy matter. But I believe there is a lot of requirement to be taking it up with the government as to whether it is the right time for introduction of such a measure in this country. Because while at one hand, we are talking about the economy facing a downturn, and on the second hand, we are introducing regulatory measures. And this is not simple, like the GST and authorities tried to make it out that it was mainly an IT thing. It was the IT department to take care of it. But I don't think it is the IT thing. As I look at it, it is something which currently faces our entire business process. And before issuing of an invoice, and a truck needs to move out only when an invoice is there. And before issuing an invoice, I need to make sure that my system talks to the GST network and gets the QR code and prints it and all that, and with a huge number of locations from which I supply, huge connectivity issues in this country, huge infrastructure problems in this country. I really don't see it a very smooth thing, and with also with the backdrop and the experience of the GST implementation, the type of changes that kept coming up, and even today when we hear the GST and authorities speak, we keep coming across issues with where they are still not sure, or they are still in talking phase and all that. So despite they have put up a confident front, I see a very painful area ahead of us. I see UltraTech losing less than 40 to 50 crores because of the introduction of e-invoicing.
Paras,
So I'm Paras Jain, and I'm head indirect taxation for the group, Wellspun Group. So Wellspun is in to manufacturing of home textiles, and we are almost into the 95% exports what we make in India. We are also into the manufacturing of steel pipes, large dia steel pipes, and then we are also into the infrastructure business and the warehousing services. It recently started. So far as like GST is concerned, in our opinion, this after the introduction of GST, I think the e-invoicing is the most revolutionary step in the direction of eventually that digitization of the business, and particularly the supply chain management in particular. So the e-invoicing system will ultimately help seamlessly routing of supply data from suppliers, systems to the buyers' accounts payable system. So that is the ultimate objective. So that will create the whole change in the scenario towards the digitization. And if you talk about that GST, in what way it is going to help us, And really, we at the Wellspun are very excited about having this to introduce because there is substantial time saving will accrue to us due to reduction in data entry. You see, that re-entry will not be required. So presently, like, we have to create GSTR1, we have to that key in the entry. So that will not be required, and the time required for the reconciliation of the data transfer will not be required. And there would be less error, or there would be hardly any error if there is no the human interface is not involved. So looking to the advantages which you are going to have, the industry is going to have, we are very really looking forward to it and very, very excited. And you see, the other advantage is that the real time tracking of the invoice is not possible. So like the data will go to the buyers as well. So the buyer can reconcile it with his purchase order and then accept or reject the invoices on real-time basis. So that is going to help us in a many ways. And so far as our preparedness is concerned, you see, like the Wellspun, when the notifications came in the month of December 2019, we immediately appointed the service providers for implementation of that e-invoicing. What the changes we face that because of the clarity not available, whether the like lot of clarity has been provided by Mr. Prakash Kumar and his Mr. Neeraj. So that was not available, whether the e-invoicing would be required for the self-generated invoices at the RCM or for ISD invoices or for the B2C transactions. And so some of the like the lot of changes has taken place on 30th July. So even that 20 new fields were added and 13 fields were removed. So these substantial changes have been made. So that the timeline is an issue. So that at least you see that at least minimum 3 months is required. So that for the implementation of this e-invoicing. Because of that paucity of time, so we are left with hardly 2 months' time. So it would be a challenge for implementation of that GST within that 2 months' period. So far as Wellspun is concerned, we are hoping that we will be able to meet this target. But if you talk industry as a whole, this would be a challenge and that time. So the one suggestions could be that why not implement it optionally from 1st of October and then make it mandatory from the 1st January 2021. So that is...
Yeah, I think all of us have suggested that to GSTN and that even to the policy wing. Hope they'll hear us and listen to us. So that would be helpful. Mohan, sir, like Mohan, what would you like to kind of...
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Neeraj. So my name is Mohan Nusetti and I represent Lupin Limited. I'm Vice President Indirect Tax at Lupin. Coming to e-invoicing, my colleagues before me, one of them first said in terms of the negative impact that e-invoicing would have. And Mr. Paras did mention in terms of the advantages that it is likely to bring to the industry. So my only take is that, it is a mix of both. We'll have to see how it pans out. If we look back in time, let's say just before GST, historically, for goods, we were doing reporting at a summary level on a monthly basis, be it under VAT or excise. And for services, it was a half-yearly sort of a reporting again at a summary level. With introduction of GST, we came to monthly transaction level reporting. And now with e-invoicing, we are getting into a real-time reporting mode where every transaction is reported to the government on a real-time basis. So this is a huge change. And there could be some challenges, but I see that there are going to be much more advantage because of this, because this is a very progressive move. And, while it is a new concept in India, it has been prevalent, as Mr. Prakash Kumar said, in over 130 countries across the world. And especially in the LATAM countries like Mexico, Brazil, there has been a great increase in revenue collections of VAT post-introduction of e-invoicing, which means that revenue leakages will reduce for the government. Honest taxpayers would be rewarded. It would actually ease the business. While the e-invoicing is traditionally discussed as if it is a tax compliance requirement. I tend to disagree. This is a business transformation which is happening, where there is discussion between business to business, and it would facilitate faster processing, bring in much more efficiency, and there are so many benefits that are going to accrue because of this for certain. Most importantly, there is this fundamental shift in terms of how data is collected and exchanged. Traditionally, we are moving away from what, you know, we have been giving information to the government, to now government is actually pulling the information and giving back to us on a real-time basis. So the kind of know that the government has in terms of the data is much, much more greater and more real-time. Coming to in terms of preparation from an industry standpoint, yes, as and when the e-invoicing was announced, you know, initially it was 1st April, now it is 1st October. We initiated the process, you know, it was two legs in that sense. One was the internal preparation in terms of looking at our IT enablement, understanding what are the changes that need to be done, looking at the schemas which have been rolled out from time to time and seeing how do we accommodate that? How do we ensure that the right data is captured and pushed to IRN, and also ensuring that, you know, the right kind of data is reflected on our invoices as may be mandated under law. And second was, of course, in terms of finalizing our business partner, the technology partner who would facilitate this whole transition into e-invoicing. Because what is most important is there is this understanding that it is not just enough to do the compliance. It is in terms of maintaining this sustainably over a period of time. And that is where the technology partner becomes very important, because we know that the government is going to come in with changes from time to time, post-introduction also. And we need to be agile enough to adapt to those changes and follow the law. Because otherwise, this could be a great business disruptor in case an e-invoice is not being able to generate at the right time. So that is how it is in terms of preparation. 1st October is a stretched timeline for sure, but I believe that, you know, we are in a position with our support of our tech partner to be able to meet the timeline. Thank you.
Pat?
Yeah, so good morning all, and really appreciate Neeraj for arranging this wonderful session, and a special thanks to the colleagues the officials from GSTN as well, who clarified a lot of things today. And we hope that, a lot more clarity, whichever are pending, should also come in the way. So Neeraj, honestly speaking, as a concept, this is a very good concept in terms of the future, addressing the future, as well as if you look at the globally, as one also said, and the officials also said, more than 130 countries have already been implemented. And as recent as some of the other Latin American countries like Panama, Paraguay, etc., so they have also been implementing. So as a concept, this is very good. But if you look at the real essence of it, the mechanism of the entire e-invoicing was devised basically to curb the tax evasion. Okay, so to put a check on the tax evasion and also to ease the compliance burden on business. But we all know that essentially the evasion primarily takes place in the B2C segment, which is out of scope as of now. So technological and infrastructural changes putting for all those B2B, while considering that what was the intent and what is the real gamut we are trying to address right now, it is all focused on B2B. So looking at the purpose, which is basically to put a tax evasion, to put a boundary on the tax evasion, is unlikely unless and until B2C segment is also covered in. So as I mentioned, the technological and infrastructural aspects would also become very important in helping this new levy stabilize and gain the confidence amongst industry, which shall be extremely helpful, you know, once we move to the next phase, when we are trying to target the industry which are below 500 crores, and also down the line when the B2C segment is also covered. But essentially, as I mentioned that, this has a lot of challenge, and as I also tried to get clarity or confirmation from the officials, that we have to put a full stop on the schema and version changes. Because as and when, at least we are now at a stage where whatever changes will come from their side, from the government side, it looks very easy. But even a small change, for example, if you are just making a small change like e-way bill date, now you're asking EWBDT. Even this small change is resulting into lot many things. And especially the MNCs, which are very, very kind of, you can say, very prompt and very, very strict in terms of having the documentation, because they require all the way testing right from sandbox development, quality, you know, and then the prod server. And then putting up everyone on the job, even for this small change, takes time. From a normal perspective, you may consider that this is a small change, nothing, you know, not a big deal. For example, a lot many things he was saying. Say, let's take an example of the QR code. He clarified today, you know, that's a good help, that for B2C, it's not needed. But if you look at this, say, notification 72, which is still is valid as on date, which talks about the dynamic QR code and the otherwise also QR code, for which the responsibility has been casted on the taxpayer to generate it. Now, assuming you are supposed to generate a QR code for B2C transactions from your SAP itself, say if your tech partner, so you also have a challenge in terms of getting the B2C QR code from your tech partner. So ultimately, you expect your SAP guys to generate and print on the B2C. It's also a challenge. If you look at what I think Mansi also tried to touch upon was in terms of the booking, what you do really with the inward side. So challenge is there, you know, how to capture the IRN code and the QR code. Though the officials clarified that the mobile device can be used, you can scan. Do you expect practically a booking guy, an accounts payable person, while booking the invoice? How do you expect him to put every time the scanner to get the QR code and then implement and build into the AP system? That's one. Second is that IRN. IRN code, though he said it's not mandatory, but if you look at this 64-digit IRN, I believe that would play a pivotal role when you go ahead in future in terms of the two-way reconciliations. So how do we expect anyone to capture IRN in terms of the booking of invoice that is a 64-digit? And if at all it has to play any role in terms of the two-way reco, will it be a challenging aspect, and practically, you know, everyone will struggle towards it. Secondly, you know, if you look at the other parts, for example, he talked about the e-way bill cancellations, etc. So it cannot be cancelled beyond a period of 24 hours. First, you have to cancel the e-way bill and then the e-invoice. As he also clarified that part cancellation of invoicing is not possible. If you'll see, especially in the service industry and also even with us, for this small change, assuming a small change is happening, has happened. Now to address that, you need to cancel the entire invoice. That's one. Secondly, is that from an MNC perspective, if you'll see, there is always a checks and balances which are put on the C&FA, which are your authorized agents for the purpose of in doing invoicing on your behalf. So you don't allow much of them to, you know, change the invoice or raise a credit note against that. So if it is not to be cancelled within 24-hour period, the ultimately what is option left is with you is issuing a credit note. If you are issuing a credit note, one, as I said, that you always have a challenge in terms of allowing multiple people to issue credit note, especially for the price differences, etc. Even if you do, now the question arises here that, say, if you are raising a credit note beyond the period of 24-hour to settle or maybe to offset the original invoice, what will happen to the e-way bill? Because e-way bill is there. So now, will there be an automatic offset which will be happening, or the e-way bill reconciliation will show some other value and your invoicing, because it's all cancelled, will show some other value? That will be another reconciliation process which the industry is worried about. Also, as I tried to, let me also capture the rounding off, though he has tried to address, but earlier, if you'll see, the authorities have clarified that instead of the truncated value, now they are going to accept the rounding off value. But if you look at the essence, that is allowing only up to 2 decimals. While if you look at the ERP system practically in any of the industry, you will not find any, say, decimal after the decimal numbers. There is no as such any restriction on that. So if your SAP invoice, your ERP, whatever invoice it is, if that is being calculated with, say, after decimal, say, of 3-digit, 4-digit or 5-digit, it is very much likely that you will end up having some value in your SAP invoice, other value in your e-way bill, which is being auto-generated, and the e-invoice. Now, any difference between the two, how the authorities are going to look into, how your purchaser, your customer, which invoice he has to believe in, whether he has to pay according to your SAP-generated invoice or the e-invoice, these are all areas which practically I think everyone is looking for, to get clarified. So conceptually, this is very good, no doubt about it. But I think I agree to the other panelists also. Unless and until the changes are not put on rest, I believe that 1st October deadline would be a tough deadline to achieve. Though everyone is trying to be there on for day one readiness, as like we others, we are also trying to be there. But considering all the challenges which are to be addressed on a prompt basis, at the same time, the further changes also need to put a full stop on it. Otherwise, 1st October is going to be a challenge. Especially going forward, the other question which can we can also think of that, can we expect any disruption? Like, you know, a colleague from UltraTech also tried to mention that there could be a disruption. Of course, there could be a disruption, because one is that, you know, if in the initial phase, how your system is going to behave, especially if you look at the pharmaceutical segment, larger billing happens in the last 3-4 days. And if you are going to do majority of the billings in your last 3-4 days or 4 or 5 days, there, if your system integration with vis-a-vis the government tool is going to take time. If you look at MNCs, basically they are not supposed to allow an outsider or maybe any third party tool to directly talk with their SAP or ERP system. It has to be, you know, connected through a middleware. And especially the challenge becomes double when the middleware has its server overseas. So then it is going to take even the longer time. So from that perspective, people have a fear that how the last minute invoicing is going to be canceled. Will there be a disruption? Will I be able to bill the entire whatever order I have? Or there could be a full stop and I have to take a hit. So it is not that only from a sales perspective. Also, it is going to affect the incentives of the people who have, you know, done the hard work in terms of especially the COVID scenario to bring those orders. So we have to be respectful of those facts as well. So I think these are the practical issues which require, you know, an attention of the authorities, that how we deal with it and provide a practical solution to go ahead with it.
I was having a very interesting discussion, and this is pro-GST and time. And
yeah,
there was one clear statement which was done, that ERPs and business will have to follow law. Law is not going to be changed for ERP and business. So that is something which will come. But a lot of these challenges that you mentioned, they have already addressed. They have removed lots and lots of validations into the system by things can work clearly. So we'll take it offline. But I'll explain you a lot of the questions that you raised. A lot of them have been answered. Ankit, and sure, then Mansi, I'll come to you and Ritesh post that. Yeah, Ankit.
Sure. So thanks, Neeraji. So brief introduction from my side. I'm Ankit Mundra and I manage taxation at CloudTail. CloudTail is one of the leading online retailers on Amazon. If you guys have been shopping on Amazon, I think you'd have realized that a lot of products are sold by CloudTail. Prakash, you also mentioned that one of the persons, I think Neeraji has been quoting CloudTail's challenges often with GSTN because of the size of business. I think I won't repeat a lot of things. I think a lot of different perspectives have emerged from the panelists within the group. I completely agree with Poddar sir that this has a potential to disrupt. Also, we need to see the timing. It's coming in October. And October is, in India, historically, it's been the peak season because of Diwali. This time, it's something that everybody is looking at, especially e-commerce, because there has been a lot of disruption upfront already because of COVID, and Diwali could be make or break season for a lot of these large corporates, large or small corporates actually. So implementation of this and possible disruption in trade could certainly, you know, dampen the whole mood of Diwali. So that apart, I also tend to agree with what Prabhat mentioned as to what exactly is the objective, right? The objective initially was to curb evasion. There were a lot of fake credit and fake invoices that were happening. But by keeping B2C out, by increasing the limit to 500 CR, initially there was a proposal to send JSONs and to keep the buyers informed real time about what's happening. That's now been dispensed off with. As a buyer of goods, you will only be informed through GSTR2. That's the only mechanism, which even today it exists, right? Nothing much will change from the buyer's perspective. So to that extent, I was not very clear as to what purpose would it serve. Even during the initial introduction, I think it was mentioned that this is basically to improve business interaction. Tax is only a resulting benefit out of it. That is not really the primary objective. So there again, I was a little confused as to what exactly are we trying to drive. And if the drive is to facilitate business interactions, I think there are different ways of doing it. This may not be the only or the right mechanism to solve. So I'll probably think of this as something which has been thought. I think it was launched somewhere last year. I think around June is when the idea was initialized. And over a period of time, it evolved into something. And now what is getting implemented is something very different. I certainly believe this is not the end state. We are just starting something. We are all realizing that there is a lot of tech challenge we are going to face. And trust me, this is not the first thing that we are going to see. October launch will have a change in December, and I'm sure the coverage will be expanded by March. So I would probably keep my IT team completely engaged. I'll probably have a dedicated bandwidth to manage e-invoice related transitions that are going to come in the next 12 to 24 months. This is certainly not the end state. As Neeraj mentioned, I think we have to gear up to what the government is asking. They will not consider the ERP related limitations. So I think we are keeping that open mind, but I think in terms of preparedness, yes, there is a possibility of disruption, and I'm hopeful that before Diwali, this is made optional and it's made mandatory only from Jan. That will be, I think, the ideal way of implementing this. That's it, Neeraj. I think otherwise everybody else has covered the different perspectives around it.
Ansi?
Thank
you.
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, ma'am.
Thanks, Neeraj. So I'm Mansi. I lead tax operations at Unilever. Unilever is basically one of the largest FMCG companies covering into soaps, detergents, etc., etc. Coming to e-invoice, without repeating much of what has been said, as a concept, it definitely is there, right? Like it's 2.0, the terms of benefits it brings, be it in transparency, be it in seamless efficiency, etc. You know, removing all this mundane work of just punching in the invoices, recording the transactions, it all is there. Having said that, the way execution is being led, I think the risk is there. The risk is very, very real. All the changes that have come till now, right? Anything that came in GST or GSTN, all the compliances were more of monthly. The only real time, if I have to take, you know, take an example, it's more of e-way bill that had come, which was more like a real-time exemption, real-time change that had a potential of disruption. You still had certain clauses there, right? If e-way bill nahi bhi generate ho raha, you can still go on. You can intimate your department. Your business does not stop. This has a very, very real risk. If my IRN is not generated, basically business stops. That's a very big risk, which no organization can afford. Not even in COVID times, not even in the normal times. So the risk is huge. And day one mandatory, not an optional period to familiarize us and to stabilize us to that. And even we have a very limited period to test the API. Even if you're making it mandatory, if you've given us 3-4 months just to test the API, you will have like multiple rounds in where you get that confidence in, okay, I'm going in. It's a new change, but we can do it. So the risk is very real, is what I'll put it. Definitely, we all are there. We all are doing it. We'll manage somehow, obviously, to land it on the 1st of October, our organizations. But I just want to bring out the risk is real here. We don't have an answer. If something goes amiss on 1st of October, we are just stuck.
Nancy, we lost you, sir.
Hello?
Sorry. Yeah, now you are audible, Nancy.
I'm saying, just to reiterate, I'm saying the risk is very real here. If something is to go miss on 1st of October, you're just stuck there. You're stuck there and that's your business which takes a hit. So that is what I just wanted to call out. So either giving us some time in terms of testing of API or making it optional to give time to familiarize, I think that would really help. The other thing, if you have to reap the true benefits of this e-invoicing, etc., is when you get the entire end-to-end value chain in it. Right now, all of us will maintain two sets of processes, two sets of IT infrastructure, one for those vendors which are not liable, one for those vendors which are liable. You're maintaining two processes, which has its own inefficiencies. So until we'll bring in entire end-to-end value chain within the whole ambit, I don't think we'll be able to realize all the benefits to that extent. Which definitely will come in pipeline. I understand on day one, none of the changes you can bring it to everyone. But then that can be handled better by giving an optional ones to the higher or the bigger turnover companies. I think that's all I had to add here.
Ritesh, how would you summarize? You heard everybody's opinion, and how would you summarize that? Because would you wear your taxation hat or would you wear your legal hat right now? Which one would be the better?
So, Neeraj, first of all, good morning, everybody. I think it's a pleasure to be a part of the panel. Neeraj, I have no choice but to, ultimately wear my legal hat on this. And what would ultimately happen is, with all of this, and I'll come to the larger part of the discussion, what people are worried about, okay? That is, we when GST came and everybody talked about it as a good and simple tax. Obviously, the introduction of GST was a good and simple tax. we spoke about automation, we spoke about, you know, filing of digital returns, we spoke about excise service tax going away. I don't think so anybody had a debate that GST is a very good law. I think what everybody is worrying about is as to how the implementation will be handled. I'm not also talking about implementation challenges. I'm talking about the handling of the implementation by the authorities. And that has been extremely poor. In the last 3 years, we have talked about filing of returns, correct? System is crashed. Transworld filing of form system is crashed. What has the government done? Come out with to say that, fine, you have to pay, go ahead and pay penalty. My transfer credits are lost. What has happened?
Yes,
I'm fighting since the last 3 years for terms of, you know, accrued rate, vested right. Everybody can just follow me.
Anupam, your voice is, I think, there's some better.
So you know, we have until date there's been fighting about accrued right, vested right, you should have the right to go credit. I think that is the worry. I don't think that anybody here is debating about the merits of invoicing, as nobody debated about GST. You know, we spoke about concept versus implementation. Conceptually, fantastic. The pain of 2-2A reconciliation every month. We have all gone through this, right? Every month, every year, end of the financial year, I'm signing my GSTR9C. And the question is, the credit not matching, what do I do? And we come out with a legal opinion, nothing doing, provisions of section 43B not activated, so don't worry. Everybody knows that notices are being issued for 2-2A reconciliation despite there being no legal provision. What is the answer to that? The government is just not accepting. What we see is a huge difference between policy and the IT system which is implementing the policy. You know, I heard today RCM. Honestly, Neeraj, it was a surprise to me that RCM, you don't have to raise an invoice. You know, until yesterday, I had a clarity that RCM is invoice.
And I'll just add to that, I have a lot of clarities of the many questions that have been raised, but the time today is kind of completely very less for us, so I cannot go into detail of each of the answers. But yes, a lot of things have been clarified, and RCM was definitely one of the points.
The question is not, you're saying a lot of it has been clarified. How it has been clarified?
Yes.
By an oral discussion? Where is the notification? Where is the law? I as a lawyer can tell you, as an advisor can tell you, sorry, you know, my law says, let's take banking. My law today worded says banking sector. And, you know, we discussed that after 1 week, they might come out with something to say that only banking services. Now, what is banking services? How do you define them? You know, so, and 500 crores, again, that was a big surprise for me to say that until now, I've been advising my client that don't worry, last year you were not above 500 crores. Now you are coming and telling me, no, that was a mistake. Now you talk about the current year. How do you expect to, you know, marry the law with the technology? How are companies supposed to prepare? The other thing, you know, we spoke about IT changes, and I don't want to, that is your domain, but every corporate is getting through this pain of IT changes, schema changes. You know, I have been into technology. I know a single field change, a single field size change. The amount of effort which goes into the ERP changes is just massive. And when you talk about global, you know, global instance, SAP or Oracle, trust me, you know, the foreign HOs are not bothered about what you Indian guys do. They say nothing doing, you manage. That's the, you know, we have seen in GST itself, clients have not implemented GST because of being a global instance. Other thing, Neeraj, I see is partial implementation, you know, above 500 crore. So where are you removing the pain of 2-2A reconciliation? Today you are saying ISD invoices, e-invoice not required to be generated. Is it good? I have to upload. You are saying, you know, B2C invoices, sectors which have been excluded. Do I then not have to upload the data? Do I not have to do the entire reconciliation again? So what is it? You know, that's another challenge. One of the largest issues that I again see is use of data. Neeraj, we saw 9-9C and how the data got misreported and how the notices started getting short. Yes, good. Government has the data. What about the use of data? I'm sure you will have 10 times more the notices to say that this number not matching with that number, A number think, not matching with
that. If you would have noticed into the presentation that you can amend all the invoices, but specifically whatever you have amended or whatever you have edited and changed into invoice will be reported to your tax officer. Now, the interesting part sometimes comes in that the IRN number, from the IRP portal, the invoice will be removed in 2 days time period. So you have to download and keep it ready. Then you have to keep the e-way bill ready, and you have to what you have filed or what is there on the STR1 and what you amended. So we were talking about a three-way reconciliation. This is increasing more and more in terms of what we are going to reconcile. And we will be, as a technology provider, I would be very happy that we are in business of providing technology. But when I see the pain of all my clients and the challenges they are facing, and my phone just does not stop ringing, whether it's a 6 a.m. in the morning or 11 in the night, I'm still answering the same questions and it's not ending. And people expect that you should be knowing or you should be answering. And I say, I can tell you what is gray, I can tell you what is black, and I can tell you what is white. But I don't sometimes even have the answers for the gray. So, that's a very correct point that these are going to be unchanted, and this is going to be the biggest disruption. I will put it across, and I put it because this is going to disrupt business. And as Mansi rightly pointed out, Ankit rightly pointed out, this is, we are going into the festive season. Post-COVID, festive season is the one thing which is going to be the most important for us, and this is happening at that particular time. So yes, that's going to be a...
Just a couple of more. So I think we should all change our designations to tax technology tax. So we should not call ourselves as... remained about, technology. So just a couple of quick more points, Neeraj. One was, I ended up on use of data, but, what about practical industry issues? We spoke about service industry. We always know that there is a billing cycle, right? So, and there could be a situation where I may actually keep my invoice ready. I may want to issue an invoice subsequently. What's wrong in that? I may not go back to it. So there has to be...
As I explained to Prakash, sir, actually, because if I file, if I raise an invoice on a 31st and do regenerate, I mean, it's like on a service invoice on a 5th or a 6th, I am paying tax in the last month, and that is beneficial to the revenue. It is not a loss to the revenue if I generate in the previous month and kind of subsequently do that. So that is
this scenario, Neeraj, is equally applicable to e-commerce, where we try to combine packages for efficiency and delivery. So where the invoices are actually generated on day one, but are shipped on day three, we wait for consolidation to happen. So it's a real life use case, I think, across
And we will have to take it up from the associations. I will genuinely request CII and GACIA's help to kind of help us take it up with the government, because they would listen to the associations much more than we present as an individual. So we will definitely want that
benefit. Absolutely. I agree with you, Neeraj bhai, and we'll certainly do that. And of course, have your inputs to be able to take it forward.
Sure. And another touch point. So I think one particular thing which is going to affect all of you is 36-4 e-invoices, partial invoices for 500 crore companies, and how the actual credit is going to really affect, because it's going to be a much more pain in terms of reconciling. Or how do you see, is this going to benefit or it's going to be a more of a challenge? So I'll just maybe go in a reverse order and start with Mansi first and go to Sanjay sir last. Mansi.
So that is actually one of the points that I had even raised. So today, for all those my vendors, when the invoice comes, I don't know if that invoice or the invoice itself is correct or not, is valid or not. And until I have a mechanism which enables me to validate or check it, where does the onus lie? Is the onus with me to avail ITC to establish that this is a valid invoice? And if not, if it is on the vendor, there's so much confusion there. And availment of ITC is one of the, the existing pain areas, which is not getting further clarified, but it's another confusion right out there. So be it in terms of two-way RICO, or we say in terms of 36-4, it's out there, right? In words. That's a big confusion area.
Ankit, even downloading your data is a 3 days job sometimes. So, kind of, is it going to add to this problem more with how do you see it on the 36-4 and the kind of credit that you
think? So I think this is where I think 36-4 is actually going to stump a lot of people, because the idea was to cover only dealers who are more than 500 crore in turnover, right? So 36-4 will apply to even the smallest of guys. So even if a person has just 1 crore of turnover, if he's buying any product, he will have to ensure that the person from whom I'm buying is not covered under invoicing regulations. And if he's covered, the QR code is valid. So this is something that's going to break the 500 crore barrier and will create a much bigger impact. You know, the area of impact will be much higher for 36.4. Yeah, as rightly pointed out, I think this to do this without technology is completely impossible. I think, Neeraj, we have been interacting with you on this as to how can we crack this puzzle. But yes, with the size of business that everybody here is managing, without a technology integration, without having a proper, you know, a simple thing, like without having a list of guys who are covered under e-invoicing, if we are expected to go and punch in each and every JustIn ID to see if they're covered under e-invoicing, it's next to impossible, right? I think we keep adding new vendors.
We requested a lot for that APIs, but those APIs are not available. So we are also trying to generate a list from our side that who all are covered under 500 crore and not covered. So whatever customer base we have, basis on that, we'll try and generate a list and share with most of you so that you get a clear idea.
I just wanted to add one thing on this aspect. You know, one of the larger worries is, you know, it's a vendor compliance, right? But yeah, look at my legality. If he's covered under e-invoice, am I eligible to take credit if he has not issued an e-invoice? You know, that I can tell you this is going to become a large litigated area on a going forward basis. You know, because his invoice is not a valid invoice. And who is clarifying that today?
So Ritesh, it must be making you very happy now. I think so.
Trust me, Neeraj, the idea is to bring solutions to the industry, not to create problems for them. And you know, the challenge is today there are issues where there is no logical answer. Forget about legal.
I agree to your point. And Prabhat, quick word on 36. Sorry, Ritesh, into that.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think we have another couple of topics I want to cover, and the time is comparatively less. So, Prabhat, a quick word on 36.4 and invoicing.
Yeah, sure. So I think you asked wrong question to Ritesh. How can he address this in public forum? Anyway, so coming back to, yeah, so certainly this 36.4 is going to be a massive challenge for everyone, and it is going to really stump. It is not going to leave anyone, you know, without touching. So considering that currently there is no mechanism to identify entities on whom e-invoicing is applicable, and if an invoice is accepted today without say QR code or so, and later on credit, if it is denied by the department, how you will defend it? So it is certainly going to lead to loss of credit and unwarranted litigation dispute, you know, as you rightly pointed out. So apart from doing 36.4, I think company would also need to build a strong internal control system in place before accepting an invoice. But that's very easy to say. It's a theoretical statement to say. But practically, if you'll see, this has its own practical challenge. How do you establish that? How do you identify? Do you expect that, you know, every accounts payable people, you know, how do you put one in the accounting system software itself? Or if not, then how do you say, for example, you know, educate your accounts payable people that these are the people who are covered, who are not covered, etc., etc. So this has its own, you know, kind of practical challenges. So an ease from the requirement from the inward side to comply with the QR code or maybe IRN for these purposes, I think that would be a certain help to business. But I'm sure, you know, it's like right now the integration is between the GST and IRP, not the GST is with ERP. So that's what the ultimate aim should be.
So I got all of you, and we were trying to get all of you together just to have that feel that all of you are sailing in the same boat. The problems are very similar at everybody's stage. Nobody is exempted out of it. Yeah, Mohan.
So true.
A quick word on 36.4 and the credit part.
Yeah. See, 36.4, I think universally we all are aligned that it is a problem. The only solution to this is that, you know, they should get broadbanded in the sense that e-invoicing becomes mandated for all supplies. That is one. And number two, if we could get that peer-to-peer sharing of data on a real-time basis, that could be a good move. You know, we know that we will reach there someday, as Mr. Prakash had said. It's a matter of time. But I think that is something that we should look forward to. But until whenever that happens, for sure, we are all in big trouble in terms of the efforts that would be required. And, you know, whatever efficiencies are there are all lost till we reach that particular stage. Yeah.
Yeah. Paras?
Yeah. So I agree with the views expressed by my friends. 36.4 is a really big area of concern. We are already facing, and now it will get more complicated with the introduction of this e-invoicing. So, because it depends upon the interpretation. So, what the field officers take the interpretation of that 36.4, whether this would apply only to the rest invoices which are not covered by that e-invoicing, or it will that 10% that would apply to the total credit which is appearing in 2A. So all these lot of issues going to arise, and it will all depend upon the interpretation how this field officers take. So that is the concern.
Sanjay sir?
So with regard to 36.4, I agree and disagree. As far as UltraTech is concerned, I do not see much of a challenge, because most of my purchases or most of my expenses are with parties who are not likely to fall into the 500 crore bracket. Even when this bracket gets revised downwards to 100 crores, my bulk of my purchases would still be lower than that. Having said that, even from a business perspective, what I think is the googly in the game is the issue about the current year's turnover being used for defining whether somebody is to issue a e-invoice or not. Had it been a static list for a year that, okay, up till last year, these are the parties and this is uploaded at some place, there could be a technological solution to recheck as you process an invoice, or as you get, you could check your masters on a back end at a periodic level. But if this list is going to get revised on a month-to-month basis or periodically, then that is a bigger challenge.
I'll just correct. There is some interpretation difference over here. So what was clarified, because I was part of another meeting yesterday, and what was very clearly clarified, that if you have post GST was implemented, so we are talking about 17-18, 18-19 or 19-20. Out of these 3 years, even if once you have crossed a 500 crore threshold, then you are part of the e-invoicing 500 crore plus things. So the current year mechanism is not being considered. The last 3 years data has been considered. And once you are into the e-invoicing system, then you are part of it completely. So then you are not getting out of it. So these were the 2 points which was clarified from the policy side yesterday into a call that I was there. So that is an interpretation I will go ahead with.
If that be the case, then I don't see much of a technological challenge. At the start of the year, I can always download that list and run my masters through that. And whenever I'm creating a new master, I can check whether that particular party is there in that list or not, and have a tagging in my SAP to make sure that when I process an invoice from that particular supplier, then I do an invoicing check, a QR code check before I actually account for the invoice. So that I don't see there's much of a challenge doing that.
Ritesh, you will be still seeing a lot of challenge into this integration.
I'm preparing a list of writ petitions to be filed on multiple issues. That is what I'm looking at. See, Sujay mentioned that, you know, last 3 years, not a challenge. Neeraj, you mentioned about policy circle, a discussion clarifying last 3 years. I don't see the law. The problem, that
the law
is,
clarification, what I have been told, will be coming in a week's time. So we can expect by August end the clarifications.
We are talking about near about 31st August. You know, and that is the concern. And there, I can tell you, 36, we are debating around 36.4. There are multiple petitions which have already been filed challenging 36.4. And yes, industry doesn't want to litigate, and therefore they are complying. As a consequence, what would happen? You would, if provisions are so impractical and which people are not able to comply, you could only see one consequence, that people go and litigate those provisions. And what the ultimate objective was, what? You know, you want to kill litigation. I would not be surprised if the e-provision, e-invoice provision per se are challenged in terms of applicability, interpretation. You know, turnover, there is a confusion on what is turnover. There would be a debate. So we are talking about an M&A transaction where two companies are merging. Both
find it. Yeah, even there are multiple challenges, and which we discussed with JSTN also, that if a company has not filed all their 3Bs, then even calculating the turnover for that particular 500 crore for that particular year has also been an issue. So these are also practical challenges. When the data has not been available with the government, then how do you calculate a turnover, and what will be the implications of it in future is definitely going to be a challenge. So that is, I totally agree with your point. Okay, this is going to be a definite challenge, and the interpretation to it, they've tried to clarify as much as possible from the available data. but this is going to be a challenge. Now, one more question. Yeah, sorry.
One fundamental point which I want to raise is, since GST has been introduced, the GST law is all about FAQs. You know, there would be very limited clarification. A law cannot be laid down by FAQs or by, you know, oral clarification. And that is where I see a huge issue. You know, what would happen is, once industry starts facing problem, they start losing money, they will just go ahead and challenge the, you will actually, you know, kill the entire effort that you have done until date. Because you go back, you know, you challenge, let's say, invoicing applicability, you challenge 36.4, you go back. The entire process goes back, because people will say, now I don't have to comply. One High Court order. The problem is, you know, please come out with the law, and please come out beforehand, so that people can start, you know, whatever needs to be done. Everybody will do it if there is a law.
Sure.
And I can tell you, you know, while here we are talking about 500 plus crore companies, not everybody is you know, law abiding or law following. They will just start picking loopholes. I will get a matter email to say that Dhruva, please register. I will write to him giving interpretation that, sorry, Dhruva is not covered. And this has happened. I've got emails to say that, you know, no, by law you are supposed to register. I said, no, sorry, there is no such law. I don't have to register. This is the... So just dispute, just imagine the dispute even on that
but
front.
The where objective is very clear that today it's 500 crore, but what Prakash sir also mentioned very clearly, that they are coming up with the time frame where 100 crore plus will also be done, and when everybody else will be done. So that time frame also, we can expect that will be clarified very quickly, and we will have the timeline on it.
Just one comment on this. Yesterday, yeah, we were having a discussion, and you know where the discussion ended. That, yeah, yes, there is a time frame, and let make the all 500 plus crore companies a scapegoat to sort of smoothen out all the issues, and then we'll come to the small player, so that up till then we are cleaning up. So this was a comment made by a very prominent
person. Yeah. One liner question, and this is like a future looking question, and because we are kind of a IT association is supporting us, so specifically for them the question is, and because this was a question Gesia people also asked and NASSCOM also asked, okay, do you see that 3 years down the line, if this entire ecosystem comes through and everything is getting automated, do you see that there will be a massive automation implemented into your organizations, by which your procurement system, your supply chains, your warehouses would be far more automated, your delivery mechanism would be far more automated than what is today, and bring in much more efficiency with the involvement of automation? Do you see that? I think Sanjay sir, we start from you.
So again, I have a different take on this. Look, business process reengineering and business process innovation is something that companies drive on their own. We don't need a law to push us into that direction. And as UltraTech, I would say we're fairly ahead. We're fairly progressive on the path of automation and paperless organization and all. And we are going on that journey without the law asking and breathing down our back. What I'm only, and this has been expressed by several of the panel members, the whole purpose of doing this particular legislative change is something which is very cloudy. An analogy that comes to my mind is, there is a popular saying that rob Peter to pay Paul, or vice versa. Now, this is a case where evasion is happening by a different segment of businesses, and you are creating challenge for the other segment of the businesses. And this is, I mean, what do you do? A smaller person, if UltraTech doesn't have the liberty or the comfort to do that, but if I were a company of 500 odd crores, I would split myself in two, three companies. Even at 100, I would, even if I was 500, 600, I would split myself in 10 companies and bring down my compliance level. I mean, what are you trying to do? You are creating barriers for us. As an industry, what we expect the government to do is make business, the process of doing business, smooth. Make it in a way, bring in regulations which are easier to handle, so that the unorganized sector, the people who are the evaders, they find it easy to comply with the law, and they find it very difficult to keep evading the law. That is what a good policy legislation should be. And I find that this government, or at least in this matter, they have been going on the reverse direction.
Paras?
So we at Wellspun believe strongly in the technology, so because the technology is the future. So rather than fear from the technology, let us embrace it and the progress based on the technology. So the 3 year down the line, definitely we are looking for the trying to achieve the kind of the objectives that we make our all the processes possible, digitization towards that goal. And you see, you can't do it alone unless your partners do it. So unless like your vendors are into the same line, and by virtue of this e-invoicing, like which will ultimately compel all the vendors to adopt that technology, to adopt for that e, and this e-invoicing will because it is in a standardized format, so it will enable all these different softwares to talk to each other. And that is how this the ultimate goal of like sitting into your accounts payable system will be possible. So this is a really, I take that in a in that perspective, that it is a small step, yes, definitely, but it will ultimately help all the business, the full business community in a great way. It will help the digitization of the all supply chain management and ultimately the business. So that is where I look forward.
Mahan?
Yeah, I think, each one of us has been part of the digital transformation journey in one way or the other at various stages. Now, this move by the government is only going to speed up that whole process. And if you are looking at, let's say, 3 years down the line, and we heard Mr. Prakash Kumar saying that it's only a matter of time that all the suppliers, all the taxpayers are going to come onto the e-invoicing platform. He also did mention that, you know, today what we are getting data on a monthly basis would become on a more real-time basis. So, you know, as a customer, if I am able to get my supplier's data on a real-time basis, that brings in so much more help in terms of building efficiencies in the whole supply chain. And, you know, we are going in a direction where many of us have already transitioned into digitally signed invoices, or we are in that journey now. So we get into totally digital paperless sort of transactions where there is end-to-end transparency. And this is something that I really hopefully wish that in the next 3 years, we will actually be there. And there would be so much of efficiency across the supply chain.
Thank you so much. Prabhat?
Yeah. What? So, sure. So I think Mohan rightly pointed out, we all are there in that journey. Okay. So because that's the future. Okay. So if you look at the forecast globally, I think the global market is to encompass 550 billion invoices annually. So that's the forecast. Okay. Now, if it is to be expected, and also it is expected to be quadruple in size by 2035. If we'll compare what has happened in 2019, if you look at the history, only around 55 billion invoices were exchanged on a paperless basis. So essentially, if you look at the entire world is moving towards complete automated solution. And I think we also as an organization have to move in the same direction, because that's the future. So the only expectation we should have from an ease of doing business from the government side as well, because unless and until the same is put up with a complete end-to-end and a comprehensive solution from the government side, including the technological support, I think the journey would be tough. So if I just quote some of the other data, if you look at the tax pay World Banking report, where does India stand? You know, it stands at 115th position. If we'll compare our nearby countries, for example, a small country which developed its economy quite later than if you talk about and compare with India, it's a Singapore. It stands at 7th position. And look at the US. US is at 25th position. So I think there is a huge journey and everyone is moving towards it. So we also as organizations do not have much of the choice, and we should actually move towards it. And the journey will require a government support as well. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Mansi?
Yes, Neeraj, definitely. I think we all should be there. Not sure, maybe in 3 years down the line or 5 years down the line, but somewhere we do see, you know, digitizing the entire procurement or the supply chain or the warehousing operations going forward. And it's not just only about, you know, punching invoices or recording data, but eventually it should also lead in something like, you know, auto filing of returns. Why should I sit and make the returns if government has all my inwards, has all my outwards, except for a few tweaks, you know, which I have to submit? everything should be automated and seamless. That definitely is the intention and hope where we should be from now. Let's see.
Okay. You already are into a digital world. So how much more digitization do you expect out of this initiative?
I think some bit of automation will be driven by our efficiency and managing of scale, and some will be because of the complexity that is imposed by the government. I think it's going to be a mix of both. I think the way e-invoicing shapes up in the next 1 year or two, I'm sure our automation charter will be driven to some extent by this move from the government, apart from our organic automation and scale management initiatives.
I think there are a lot of people who have sent one particular question, and really means like they are questioning, is there a production system available and ready, and are we live onto it, or government is live onto it? So I'll just take a 2-minute demo break into it before we end the session, because that is important for people to be convinced that the government, NIC is already live with productions. People like us are live with production and e-invoices are being generated. So Viral, can you just show a quick demo to the panelist and the audience onto that part a little bit quickly? Yeah, Viral. Viral?
Yeah, Neeraj, give me a moment, please.
You can share your screen and...
Definitely. Give me a moment, please.
So all your companies can actually start generating e-invoices even from today. And that is kind of systems are ready from the government side and available. So possible to do that.
Okay. So, Neeraj, are you able to view the screen?
Everybody?
So this is a Signet GSP, a new system that we have built all together. So which comprises of e-invoicing module.
And it'll be a little bit quick. We are very short of the time. So
definitely.
Just don't go into deep explanation, but show the invoice, generate an invoice and show that.
Definitely. So this is the invoices which I have already uploaded into the application. I would select few of them and I would try generating the sale. So
this is the production system which is being shown over here.
Yeah, so this will show the progress that is being happening for the invoice generation. It's already pushing the data to the IRP, and it says the invoice has been generated successfully. So the invoice will be generated and it will be applicable. So in case if there are any errors from the government, it is currently saying description of password field, which is a rare thing. We'll push it again. It's happening since morning.
So yeah, this type of challenges still will be there.
Yeah, so now again we are repushing it again.
Meanwhile,
So again it's the same thing, I guess. Yeah, description of password. This is the string.
Yeah, you can just show the
I already have a generated invoice as well as a cancelled invoice. So I already cancelled it. So this is a generated invoice, that is IRN, which is already generated. And it's currently the cancelled state. So I generated it and then cancelled it. You can download an entire PDF here. So this will download the PDF in front of you.
And this QR code can be scanned by any scanner and you will get all the information.
Yes. So you can go ahead and scan the QR code. That is out there. So this is an actual invoice from one of our Signet Group companies. And we will be able to scan it and do it. So if you have mobiles available with you, you can scan it.
Yeah. That's okay.
Okay.
I think that's all. Thank you so much for this quick demo, because we are already at 12:30. So I think.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Viral.
Thank you. Thanks.
Anupam ji, some closing comments from you. Hello. Anupam ji, some closing comments from you.
So thank you, Niranji, for for such a detailed panel discussion. It was very interesting to note the new development happening in the GSTN. And on behalf of KCI and CII, I thank you, the panel, and the GSTN for giving us such insight on this development. And definitely there are challenges and issues which I'm sure all of us would be gearing up to solve that. So thank you once again, and it was very interesting discussion. And just to mention that we had about 930 plus viewers who had watched this discussion. So this was definitely something very interesting to note. Thank you, Niranji.
Thanks for sharing the number. It's very heartwarming, and thank you so much. Thank you so much all for being part of the panel. Really, really appreciate from my end. And any queries, any questions, we are always available. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Have a wonderful day and a great weekend. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ritesh.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.